We are here in Las Vegas, another iconic show. I just have had a really great time in Vegas. And again, thank you, NAB. Thank you again, Lensec. And we're going to have an unbelievable guest. I remember a couple years ago when I brought up the Blue Man. I get to interview someone from the Blue Man. I said, wow. And my memories of it, it's just, you think of that blue face and you think of the just who they are, and everyone knows who they are. Well, I was in Vegas, and I said, I got to reach out. So I'm very excited to welcome to the program Kaylin Allmendinger of the Blue Men. Kaylin, thanks for stopping by. I love, before we go into any questions, I just absolutely love the show.
Oh, thanks so much.
It was so interactive, so entertaining, so much fun, and I'm sure it really... after doing 2 to 3 shows a night, you're pretty exhausted by this point in time, at this time of night.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, you feel it after a couple of shows, but also you get so much energy from the audience that a lot of times I feel kind of wired, you know. And when I go home, I usually get home around midnight, and it's hard for me. I have a 6-year-old daughter that, you know, gets up and goes to school in the morning. And it's hard for me to just go right to sleep and get enough rest to wake up with her the next morning, because I'm usually wired after a show. You know?
So when I was a professional wrestler, it would take me hours to go to bed. And then I'd be at 2, 3, 4 in the morning. By the time we got out, and then we went out, had dinner,
right,
and went out, people, it's like, forget it. Yeah. You're just wired.
You know,
because
exactly how it feels.
Because when you deal with performing, the performance of interacting with the crowd, and that's professional wrestling, and that's what you do in the theater, or that's what you do in Blue Man. You are performing with a crowd. You really live through that energy, that crowd, right?
Absolutely. It's the crowd, and, you know, there's a big physical element, obviously, in professional wrestling, but also with Blue Man, we don't use our voices. It's all physical storytelling and, you know, nonverbal communication. And yes, between the energy of the crowd and the physicality of the show, and I think almost more than any of it, just the kind of mindset, you know, when you're committed to that character that you're playing, and he's got this heightened kind of emotional life, you know, everything is high stakes, and so that just kind of gets
adrenaline
pumping.
And you guys tell a story from beginning to end. And that's important. Storytelling is something that keeps an audience engaged from beginning to end.
Right. There's always something. I think the nonverbal part of it is helps for the audience to stay engaged, because they're a part of it. They're kind of writing, they're justifying what's going on in a certain way. Maybe, you know, thinking about why we're doing what we're doing, or, you know, it looks like those guys don't like each other, or they're fighting, or he's always trying to catch up. Or, you know, you kind of bring your own world to it, because we're not spoon feeding it. We don't have lines. We're not seeing exactly what's happening, but you know, it's always a status game, and there is always somebody who's trying to sort of catch up to the other two. So it's very basic kind of rules of comedy, really. You know, it's kind of a villain.
Yeah, I never thought of that when I talked to Matt Phelan a couple years ago. I really just looked at the history of it, and that's all I'm sticking with in this interview, because everyone needs to check out my interview about Blue Man and the origin of Blue Man to the point where how they toured and how they grew to this point where there are events like Vegas all of in other cities as well. So you don't have to wait for the national tour, the world tour, if you're in certain cities. Now let's kind of go right into it. Did you always want to be a performer?
Pretty much. Yeah. I my grandfather played drums, and I was really looked up to him, and he gave me a pair of drumsticks when I was really little. And even before that, my dad would set up shovels and hubcaps and tires and buckets, and I would just bang on them, you know, makeshift drum kits. And then my grandpa gave me a pair of sticks and my first snare drum, I think when I was maybe 2 or 3. And then, you know, I inherited this old kind of junky drum set when I was a little older than that. And then eventually, probably when I was in junior high, I don't know, preteen years, I got my first... Actually, even before that, I think it was like in 5th or 6th grade, because that house was in it. But anyway, that's when I got like my first really nice drum set. And so I've played drums from an early age. And then when I was in high school, I started doing the plays that we produced. I got the acting bug, and I studied acting in college in Chicago at the Chicago College of Performing Arts.
Oh, wow.
And at Roosevelt University. And yeah, and I've always enjoyed, I continue to play music when I can with friends, right. And I've done some other acting gigs here and there. But I actually got hired by Blue Man right after college. So
oh, wow.
Since then, I've been doing this on and off.
Favorite drummer of all time?
I can never answer. Just there's not one, you know. There are so many that are so impressive. If I had to just say one, it's probably Steve Gadd.
Okay.
Probably Steve Gadd. Yeah, he's always flawless. I don't know.
Do you ever see yourself ever in a band as a drummer?
Yeah, that would be really fun. And I do get to play with friends every once in a while. Sometimes they'll call me up and say, you know, we're playing covers at a restaurant or whatever. And that's always fun just to kind of go and have and play. But I actually have a project that with a friend here in Las Vegas. He makes a lot of instruments, and we do this sort of noise feedback loopy kind of thing, which we like a lot and is often unlistenable, but it's a lot of fun.
So is there a track for all this music? Because it can get really in my mind. It's still in my head right now, the drumming. And this the different things of the music that goes throughout the whole show. You guys do you have that as a track or anything that people can listen to some of that music?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we have 3 records.
Oh, really?
And a couple concert DVDs, live performances of the rock concert style show that we did. One of them is called The Complex, which I was actually on. And then after that, it morphed into How to Be a Megastar. And it was a lot of the same music, but a little more character stuff in it. But those are both available as concert DVDs. And then there are 3 studio albums that we recorded as well.
Awesome. How did you audition for the Blue Man Group? You said you got out of it. You got it pretty early. You were kind of telling the story. Yeah. Acting was going on during while you're doing this. So tell us. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was studying acting in Chicago, and I was a freshman, and it was a friend of mine who was in the program with me saw that that Blue Man was holding open call auditions.
What?
It was before they opened the Chicago production. And he knew that I played drums, and he knew that I looked the part physically, that we try to keep it as uniform as possible. And so he encouraged me to go audition, and I did. And they told me at the audition to finish school, that they didn't want to pull me out of school.
Oh, wow.
You know, I was pretty young. I was probably 19 years old. They said, finish school, and if you're still interested, then, you know, give us a call.
Right.
Keep in touch. And so I did. I went back to school, and I kept studying, and I did a lot of shows in school. And around Chicago, that was one of the fun parts about my program. I was able to actually kind of start working professionally even before I graduated. And in the meantime, the Chicago production of Blue Man opened, and I saw it, and I thought that indeed that was something I'd like to give a try. And so when I graduated, they flew me out to New York, and I went through kind of all these callbacks for a week, and that's when I was hired.
So once you do the auditioning, you're hired, you don't just get placed to Vegas, right? It's a process. Yep. You have different teams, right? Explain that.
Yeah, so we have a show in New York, which is where it originated. There's one in Boston, Chicago, here in Las Vegas, Orlando, Berlin, and a couple world tours at the moment. And there are different tours at different times, and shows have opened and closed. But all of those city shows that I mentioned have just opened and continue to run. They're open-ended performances.
Oh.
So there's a good chance that you could go to any one of those. So when you're going through, you train in New York, learn the character there, you start with one role, and then you start to go into the show there in New York. And once you're sort of signed off on, and they say, okay, you're ready to go to one of the cities, you can say, you know, I'd love to go to this place or this place if possible, but it's really up to the stars, you know, who's needed where. And so, yeah, you're kind of, it's like boot camp.
So when you get Vegas, you were happy because, again, of being an actor, that's perfect, right? To be in Vegas because of how close you are to LA and different things like that?
Yeah, that's a part of it. I've been here in Las Vegas for about a year and a half.
Okay.
Actually, coming up on 2 years now. And I've done the show on and off since 2000. So most of my time as a Blue Man has been elsewhere. And I have covered shows here before, but I've never, this last year and a half has been the first time that I've been a full-time cast member here.
So acting's theater, or do you do other acting as well?
Yeah, I've done theater and a little bit of film and television, some commercials. We used to live in LA and I would audition quite a bit, and I booked a couple commercials, and I did some voiceover work. I do audiobooks every once in a while, narrate audiobooks.
Do you have any dreams in what acting would you want? What is your dream as an actor? Where do you want to go there?
I enjoyed what I'm doing right now, but it's also fun to learn a new character. So it's been a while since I've done a play of any kind, and I would love to do that again. And it would be fun to do more film work. That's been fun, what little I've done.
Because if you're doing so many shows, there's really not much time, is there?
Yeah, it's kind of tricky to... I mean, we work nights and weekends, and so and it's pretty consistent. And we don't have a set schedule. It's flexible within the week, but as a full-time performer here, there's not a whole lot of time you have to take time off of the show if you want to go do another production, because they're both just too...
And then they'll send somebody from somewhere else to your spot in Vegas.
Yes, exactly. And there is some room for that. You know, we have vacation that we can accrue and take time off. So I could, you know, audition for a show and go do something else.
Right.
But I've sort of quit and come back and done different things throughout my time as a diplomat too. So it's a good steady gig that's always going to be there. Well, not always, but so far, you know, there's been enough success that I've been able to come and go, and that's been really great.
Did you know about the Blue Man Group before you auditioned?
No, not that first time. I had never seen it. Oh, yeah. I think I may have seen something. They'd done a few appearances on maybe The Tonight Show.
Yeah, that's where I remember. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think I kind of had this vague awareness of them. And they started in New York. They opened their show around the same time Stomp opened their show. And so they were both these off-Broadway New York, you know, East Side things that were non-traditional and their own things, very musical, percussion, you know, both have percussion. So it was kind of in the conversation, but I had never seen it, no.
Right.
Not until they opened their show in Chicago.
That's cool. How cool is it to perform in Vegas versus other cities? Now, I guess you're a Vegas guy now, but before, like, what did you see the difference of
Vegas? Oh, it's
Vegas.
Great. Yeah. I love it here. We have a great cast right now, and it's I've worked with a lot of these guys in different productions, one of those tours I mentioned, for example, and just different shows here and there. One guy I worked with in Tokyo for a while, and so it's nice to kind of come here and see old friends that you've worked with in different places, but also all the new people the people that I've working with for the first time here. And, you know, backstage, on stage, everybody across the board is just, it's a really relaxed place to work, and there's so much talent, so it's really inspiring, and we keep each other challenged, and Vegas is a really, I'm discovering, it's a really tight-knit community. We've had some opportunities to collaborate with Cirque du Soleil on a couple concert appearances and outside performances here and there. And then just seeing local theater here in town and going to parties and, you know, meeting different performers. And a lot of people, it's a small world here, you know. And
celebrities that are fans of the Blue Man Group that you met here.
That I've met here?
Yeah.
Let's see.
you can answer that too. You can.
Well, there have been a lot over the years. I'm trying to think of who I met recently.
Dancing with the Stars was really excited when we were there.
Yeah, well, we had an appearance on Dancing with the Stars this past season.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and that was a lot of fun. And of course, there were a bunch of celebrities there competing, and then all the dancers. Everybody on that production was super welcoming and just made us really comfortable, and we had a blast. But yeah, like Donny Osmond was there, and he was really sweet. Uh-huh. And who else? I'm trying to think.
The gymnast.
Mary Lou Retton. Yeah. She was fun. Yeah. And so, I mean, over the years, I've been able to meet a lot of famous people. We've done, you know, we've done big talk shows, Ellen and Leno and all
that's
that.
That's gotta be cool.
Yeah. It's always kind of weird to see these celebrities, but, I know Frankie Muniz has been a big Blue Man fan. I've never met him, and I think he lives here in Las Vegas too. But he used to come to the show quite a bit.
Oh,
I know he was a fan. Yeah.
let's talk about the preparation. Because again, I mean, you have to be on cue. There's no way of making a mistake because of how the performance is scripted and developed, that you make a mistake, you could screw things up very easily. So talk about preparation for each performance.
Well, it's good to, like I mentioned earlier, it's a physical show, so it's good to warm up a little bit, especially, you know, warm your hands up and do a little drumming, because not only is it physical, but we're playing through paint. We have, you know, play on these drum heads that are soaked in paint, and there's it's not an ergonomical way to play. And then also these PVC instruments that just sort of send vibrations. There's no give. Yeah. They just kind of send the vibrations right up into your arms. So it's good to stay limber. And then we just kind of, sometimes I'll warm up more or less, kind of physically do a little yoga to get stretched out and loose. But it's more of a mental thing. You know, we kind of just joke around and have fun, and you sort of take the temperature of the room. You know, we share a dressing room, and it's good to just kind of get loose mentally and challenge each other in different ways. And, you know, so we'll kind of tease each other, or we'll, you know,
how are you able to like catch things in your mouth?
Practice. Just
and so at first you weren't getting it, right? It didn't happen overnight that you catch it all.
Yeah, it's an odd thing, you know. Yeah. It's not something you're sort of born with. But like anything, you kind of keep your eye on the ball, so to speak.
And see, even though I'm not very attentive, which one were you, on the left, right, or center?
Tonight I was on the left from you. I was stage right, so on your left. I was catching the gumballs and making the painting.
Yeah, that's very, very impressive.
Yeah, thank you.
I don't know how that's done. I mean, now say, audience, don't try that at home. That's for sure, right? Yeah. Especially the one with the marshmallows.
Right. Yeah.
There's got to be something more to this, like sleight of hand, maybe, in that type of thing.
That's what everybody thinks, but it really is just what it looks like. We shove it. You know, it helps to kind of get some as much as possible into your cheeks.
No. You're kidding.
Spread it out, but. We just shove a bunch in our mouths.
Well, as I told you, you said that I would not be able to become a blue man. You got to have the giant blue man. You got to talk about this. Bring in a 7-foot blue man next year, Vegas, when I'm here. You already got to have it set up. I'll be ready. And
I'm intrigued.
Let's keep talking about that. Play with that gimmick. You never know, because again, we all come up with these different things, and you never know. So what are your goals, would you say, as a performer in the Blue Man Group? Because you've done it for years.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where do you want to retire a blue man, or when would retirement be? How long do you want to perform in this? Especially when you have other goals for yourself. You have acting as a goal. You have music as a goal. Yeah. Do you see yourself retiring early, or moving on, or you want us to be on for a while?
Right now I'm enjoying it, you know, and I think part of what's been sustaining for me with this job, it's been almost 19 years on and off.
Right.
like I said, I've been, here and there, kind of doing it and coming and going. So that helps that it hasn't just been one cast the whole time. And in that time, I've done sort of usually about a year in each city. And then I get to go to a new place, and I've done tours and I've done international shows. So that keeps it fresh. Right. And, you know, you're always working with new people. And so I don't know if another opportunity arises where, you know, it's a place that's really intriguing that I've never been, or for whatever reason, you know, I think we're always talking about what the next city is going to be, or the next tour. And
you could also be a trainer at one point in time when you're close to done, where you could be the one that helps with the production if you keep growing and adding more cities.
Yeah, absolutely. That's something I've done in the past, and that's always a fun new way, you know, to use your brain in this. And it's a really collaborative job, you know. Sometimes when they're writing new material, they'll workshop it, and you get to, if you get to be a part of that, you know, you get to have some input and help kind of create new material. And so, you know, as long as it's fun, you know, it's just a fun thing.
And when you mention is that you got hired and this is a job, it's not like acting, or you're a part of a production team, a team that's year round. It's not like something else. So how is that structured? You know, you go get hired for, let's say, Cats, it's only for X amount of time, or you're going for a different theater. You're part of this group. How's that put together, like contract-wise and all that stuff?
Well, I'm a company member here. So, you know, as long as I'm in good standing, I'm an employee of this company. I don't have a set end date in my contract.
I see.
I'm just a company member of this show. And it's kind of open-ended, you know.
And you like the fact that it's good to, as an actor, performer, to have a gig for this long.
Yeah,
because that's very hard to keep that thing.
Employment is it can be really nice, for sure, yeah. You can start to make plans and think about, you know, retirement, and you can put money away, and yeah, it's a job.
One question before I'm done I was thinking about is the performances are not always the same. So you're always trying to change things up. How's that collaborative saying, let's try this a little bit? You have your certain things that are always part of the Blue Man, but what about other things that you decide to try? I'm sure that you didn't have the iPad thing years ago because it wasn't in the end thing, and then you keep changing it.
Well, we have there's some folks who work out of New York who are specifically tasked with writing new material. That's their primary job. There's this very small creative department that's always coming up with new things. And then they'll send something out, and somebody will work on it in a certain city. And we have directors that travel around and kind of keep up the shows artistically. And they'll bring in some new material and say, hey, we want you guys to look at this. You know, they'll film something and say, learn this and have some rehearsals and let us know what you come up with. In fact, we're going to put some new material into the show over the summer here in Las Vegas. It really varies. Sometimes, I mentioned we have three records.
Yeah.
Whenever they've written the music for a record, that music has created a new show.
Okay.
And then that new show has trickled. Pieces from that show will kind of find their way into existing shows. So we don't necessarily change everything all over at once, but we'll put a new song in or, you know, update things. And then sometimes it is a bigger shakeup, and it's a lot of new stuff. So that always varies, and it is a collaborative process.
So tell me about the fans. Because, again, some will come multiple times to Vegas to watch you. How crazy are your fans, like, that are into this?
Well, we don't have any, like, salacious stories, really,
Not
that kind of crazy. But we do have some very loyal fans, and that's always great to see those familiar faces. And, you know, these are people who are, they have, first of all, obviously, many choices here in Las Vegas alone of other entertainment to go see. And the fact that they keep choosing to spend their money to see us, and that they continue to get something special out of it, you know, whatever it means to them, is really an honor. You know, it's really great to see those people that commit, you know, their time to come and pay your paycheck. You know, really, and it is, you know, we try to have like a kind of an event each show. It's like it's kind of a special, unique version of it, at its best. So it's kind of, I always appreciate those folks. And it's one of those shows that, you know, if you live here locally, it's a good one to kind of bring guests to, you know, have a good time.
So the best place we can follow and find out information about the Blue Man Group, where can we go?
You can go to blueman.com.
Okay.
And they've got, you can pick a city. It'll have all the information about tours and all of our different productions there. We also, of course, have all the social media stuff. You can follow us on Instagram and get updates and
Twitter, stories. Facebook, all the places.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thanks. I appreciate the time and learning more about what you do.
My pleasure. Yeah.
All right.
Nice
thanks.
Chatting with you.
Appreciate it. You're listening to Neil Haley's Show, and we'll be back in just a moment. We are here in Las Vegas at the Harrah's, and I'm also at the NAB and doing much more things here in Las Vegas, again, sponsored by Lensec. Visit Lensec.com for more information. And I'm here with Bill Medley of the Righteous Brothers and Rock and Roll Hall of Famer and much, much more, aren't you?
Well, I'm 78, I know that. So I'm old enough to be in all those things, yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. So let's kind of go into how you got involved in rock and roll first. Kind of give me a little bit of a taste of that.
Well, the short story is Little Richard.
Okay.
I was 15 years old in 1955. First time I heard Little Richard, it really changed my life. I mean, my mom and dad were musicians, and I always was around music, sang in church choirs, school choirs, but you know, it was very kind of unemotional to me. And then I heard Little Richard, boy, and I just, wow.
Oh my gosh, I can't think. I mean, he was such an amazing performer.
The greatest rock and roll singer in the world still today. I mean, for me.
Yeah.
And then, so when I heard Little Richard, it really, you know, got my juices going about music. And then a friend of mine, Don Fiducia, had wrote a song. And I would sing along to the radio, and everybody would know that
yeah.
I could sing.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
sound
yeah,
like
yeah,
that.
Right, 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 right.
And so he wrote a song. He said, Bill, would you sing this song? I want to hear a real singer do my song.
Oh, my gosh.
I said, well, I'll try and find one for you. And so I learned the song, and I sang it. And that really got me started as a writer, writing music. And I really considered myself in the beginning as a singer-songwriter.
Okay.
And every time I would sing some song for somebody, they'd say, well, boy, you should record it. Same
right.
thing that we used to say to Carole King. What are you giving this? You should be doing that. And then I got into another friend of mine had a blues band, and I got into B.B. King and especially Ray Charles. Ray Charles.
Oh, wow.
Little Richard made me want to do it. Ray Charles made me need to do, sing.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, he was the best. He was the best.
Oh, it means definitely seems like he was the best. And what did you emulate from him and stuff?
Well, you know, I didn't emulate. I mean, and people don't believe me, but it's the truth. I never bought any of his albums. I would just listen to him.
Right.
And I never copied him. I didn't copy anybody. And a lot of people won't believe that because in the early
right.
days, I sounded very black, rhythm and blues.
Yes.
And
so that time period, what was it considered? The birth of rock and roll almost in that point? Or?
Well, in 55.
Yeah.
You know, from 55 to 60, that was really rock and roll and us white guys learning it and loving it, falling
yeah.
in love with rock and roll. And then in the 60s, it's kind of my opinion that from the 60s on, it was kind of the white guy's version of rock and roll
yeah.
and even rhythm and blues. And I shouldn't say it, but I've always said, listen, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame should have started in 55 and stopped in 60, because that's real rock and roll. Even the early Elvis Presley.
That's so true.
That's
yeah.
rock and roll.
Yeah.
The rest of it is white guys' opinion of rock and roll. The Beach Boys, the Righteous Brothers, the you know Four Seasons.
Yeah.
That's our opinion of it. So anyway, that's my opinion.
So from that process. So at that point in time, when you were learning from Little Richard and trying to develop things, did you think you were going to be as successful as you are?
Oh no, no, no. I'm. Without question, the luckiest man in the world. I mean, I quit school when I was 16. Kids, don't do it. Look what
okay.
happened to Uncle Bill. and I just was headed into a mountain. I honestly, man.
Right.
I just I loved music and this and that.
Right.
And then got a little band together
right.
and this and that. And then bought a friend of mine put Bobby and I
okay.
together, and then Bobby and I
right.
just clicked, and it just happened.
And then you had that feeling. Once you knew it clicked, look out.
Well, you know what? I really would like to say that Bobby and I had something to do with it, but Bobby and I had nothing to do
okay.
with it. Bobby and I, the Righteous Brothers, never asked for anything.
Okay.
a guy came to where we were singing in a nightclub. I wrote a song called Little Latin Loopy Lou. He said, I love that song. Let's record it.
Okay.
So we recorded it and some black Marines used to call us the Righteous Brothers, so we used that name. And nothing happened. Then a friend of ours took us to a teenage dance place, the Rendezvous Ballroom, and we were the Righteous Brothers, and they loved right. the dance to Loopy Loop, and it just took off. Then Phil Spector came, and this came, that came, and we never asked.
You never asked for anything. How'd you come up with the name of the Righteous Brothers?
When we were both from Orange County, California, and it was very white in those days.
Okay.
It was really happy days is what it was. And but there was a Marine base, El Toro Marine base, and a lot of the black Marines heard that these two white guys were down at the club singing rhythm right. and blues. And they would, so they started coming down to see us, and they had a saying, like, if you saw a great
right.
car where us white guys, right. what a bitchin' looking car.
Yeah.
They said, man, what a righteous looking car. Well, they started calling, they'd say righteous to us, meaning good. And if they liked you as a friend, they'd call you a brother. So they'd say, hey, righteous brother, how you doing? And when we needed a name, when we did Little Latin Loopy Lou, I think it was Bobby that said, we ought to use the name that the Marines have been calling us. That's how we got our name.
Wow. And do you think a name has a lot to do with the success of a band? Not just, it was funny, I was watching the movie on Netflix about Motley Crue and how Motley Crue had some really dumb names.
Mm-hmm.
And they came up with something, said it stuck. When you heard that, you knew it stuck.
Well, yeah. I mean, Bobby wanted to call it Bobby Hatfield and Friend.
You sound like how these wrestling promoters are doing now, where they got rid of the gimmicks and never come up with the right name. Because a name has a lot to do with success. I mean,
a lot to do with it.
Because that's what's on the billboard.
Yeah. Yeah, that kind of spells out who you are, what you are. I mean, the Beatles, I don't know if they look like Beatles. But but the Rolling Stones, I thought that was a great name
yes.
for the time. And but Righteous Brothers, you know, people were getting hip to the name Righteous, and it certainly wasn't coming from the biblical
right.
sense. You know, no man should call himself righteous. It wasn't. We weren't calling ourselves the perfect people, but we were. It was just they were calling us good friend. Hey, Righteous Brothers, Righteous.
Wow.
So we loved that, and we were singing black. We were singing rhythm and blues, and a disc jockey in Philadelphia, when they finally started playing mm-hmm. our music, they wouldn't play white music because it was a
yes.
black radio station. Just like
yes.
a country station wouldn't play opera.
It's where
it wasn't
yeah.
it wasn't that. And white stations wouldn't play it.
African American music.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
So we were caught in the middle. Finally, one of our records came out, and radio stations said, "Now that's it. Righteous Brothers are black. That's it. We're playing them." But the disc jockey started telling their audience, "Here's my blue-eyed soul brothers," which was telling them, "These two guys are white,"
right.
and because the blacks would refer to a white guy in the 50s,
right.
a blue-eyed. And so that's how Blue-Eyed Soul came about. So the cool thing about everything about
right.
the Righteous Brothers, because we were doing them. We were doing
yes.
black music.
So that's got. So was that challenging to some of the African-American artists because of the black doing that?
You know what, man? We were just embraced by the black artist and by the public, and they didn't have to do it, man, but they just did. The good thing about country music and rhythm and blues, if you're good, they don't deny it.
Yes.
It's just because it's emotional.
Yes.
And if you're bad, well,
you're bad. So you got along with the different artists. Name some of the artists you toured with.
Well, you know, we were so lucky and became big. So, well, the first artist we traveled with, we opened for the Beatles. Yeah.
Are you kidding? You have probably stories from that, for sure.
Oh, yeah. yeah, by the book.
That's great. I didn't know about that, so that's great. Buy your book. I love it. See, I'm going to give you a pound for that one. Because buy your book, that's what we don't want to tell. That's, we'll say, buy the book, check out the story. But that's the greatest thing. You got to work with people like the Beatles. The Beatles help you in a way to say, hey, when you saw how their stardom was coming, how you're going to handle this.
Yeah, you know, being on the Beatles, well, first off, nobody knew who the Beatles were, at least artists, you know, we didn't know. They were just little girls, you know, the underground. And so we went on that. We were asked to do this Beatle tour, and we said, okay. And we went on it, and it was just, it was amazing.
Right.
I mean, on a lot of different levels, mm-hmm. for a lot of different reasons. It was amazing to see the reaction. It was amazing to kind of see the whole world flipping.
Exactly.
A young generation, which I hope is going to happen politically for this country.
Yes.
That the younger people start to take over. And then we were the opening act for the Rolling Stones on their first American Beatle tour. And then when we hit, and they were wonderful, and the Beatles were wonderful. But when we hit with Love and Feeling, Love and Feeling made such an impact that we didn't need an opening act.
Right.
Or we took acts with us like April Stevens and Nina Temple and people, Glenn Campbell was the opening act. And then 2 years later, we were his opening act. So we were pretty fortunate to be able to do our own tours.
Yeah.
Because we never did the Dick Clark tours.
All right. Wow. And so in that process of working with these great talents and things like that, then you're the act. How did you deal with stardom? Was it the right way, or is it another? We have another story like the days of the road for bands at that time in rock and roll? You have some stories just like all these other artists do, and certainly buy the book and talk to
them. Buy the book. Now, you know, in the early 60s, it wasn't so much sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Okay.
You know, drugs hadn't really, you know, come in.
Are you kind of glad when you were that age that it didn't happen in like the other ages, like where Ozzy and Molly, you know, just thinking about that time, if you would have gotten exposed to that level, who knows?
Well, I was exposed to all of it, you know, coming up through the 70s and all that. And but I was so busy. I produced all the Righteous Brother albums and singles, all except when we went with Phil, but I still did the albums. I was just so busy that I just didn't have time for that nonsense. I didn't drink. Well, I drank a few beers.
Okay. But so you got to do
a lot of beers. but I just needed to be clean headed to go in to work with an orchestra and bands. And I just didn't need it, and I'm just the kind of guy that I'm a control kind of, probably a control freak.
So
when you're on drugs, you're really not in control,
right? Exactly.
So that kept
you from doing that. So how did you handle the stardom? Did you guys handle it well?
No, you know, I would. Bobby and I, here's how we handled it. Bobby and I were raised in Orange County, so Hollywood was 40 miles away.
Okay.
You know, if you're from Texas, and you had to come to Hollywood, then
that's a lot bigger difference. Drive right to L.A.
We just stayed home, and the guys that I ran around with were still the guys I went to high school with.
Okay.
I was just the guy that sang.
Okay.
You know, and so that helped a lot. And I've even written songs about, you know, guys that had to come from the South or whatever and come to L.A. and get caught up in all that and get, you know, on drugs and all that.
Because they'd never been exposed to it. And you at least knew, being in Orange County, hey, you made trips to L.A. You knew some people. You were a different thing. You know how to live the scene in a certain way once before you hit your success.
Yeah.
Now, let's talk about you. What do you think your two biggest songs? Because I was doing a Wikipedia search, be honest with you, just because we just set this up early. Mm-hmm. I'm good at remembering things when I was walking over reading the Wikipedia, and I recognize certain songs. Again, and then when I say them, I'm like, iconic songs. Mm-hmm. So what would you say are two most iconic songs? Or I recognize two of them, but I wanted to hear what you think.
Well, now, because of the movies that came out in the end of the 80s, it's certainly Love and Feeling and Unchained Melody are probably the two biggest. Unchained Melody wasn't until Ghost. It was a hit in the 60s, but Ghost made it.
Oh, my gosh. You would have been smiling year to year when they chose that.
We didn't even know they chose it. We were told that Love and Feeling was in Top Gun, and we were told that Unchained Melody was in Ghost. We didn't have a clue. I knew I've Had the Time of My Life was obviously going to be in Dirty Dancing. And the truth is, Time of My Life...
You were single then, right?
Yeah.
So that's I wanted to get to that point. So I'd say three you've brought up that are made... Wow.
Yeah, I'm in The Soul and Inspiration, Just Once in My Life, and but Little Latin Loopy Lou has a real place in my heart. Maybe because I wrote it, but it really started everything for us. And
you'll live on forever because of those three iconic movies you brought up.
Because it's two different careers. I mean, we had those in the 60s, and then let's do it again in the 80s.
Hey, that's why you have a show in Vegas. That's right, exactly at the Harrah's. So you got to come and check you out anytime you're in Las Vegas.
That's right.
For sure. Wow. Yeah. I mean, I just can't imagine, you know, how your career continues to live on. I think it also helps now with streaming services that new fans become fans of your music.
Yeah.
Compared to before, hey, we have to be played on the radio. Those days are done. Now it's, and people could just live those genres, share them to other people, and it's nice.
Yeah, you know, my daughter, who's, in my opinion, a great singer, and she's a songwriter, she lives in Nashville, and even 30 years ago, when she, you know, or started wanting to get in the business, and I didn't even know what tell her what to do, because it had just totally changed. It's a little like Vegas here. I'm asked all the time, how's Vegas changed? I said, not a lick. It hasn't changed a bit. It ain't here. The Vegas that I knew in 65 literally is not here.
Wow.
Not the buildings, not the people. It's gone. And they've built bigger and better and more credible
giant, places. Gigantic casinos in different places.
But it's just different slack. But the business just isn't there. It just isn't. Or the business that I knew.
It's a different business because the way you measure success is different than you measured success before.
Yeah.
Guys have to tour more than before. They were making money off record deals.
Yeah.
Now it's you got to go out and tour.
Well, you know, it's
or have an opportunity like you have here.
It's real interesting because when we started recording, you would put out a single, so it would be a hit, so they would go buy the album.
Right.
And you want them to buy the album so they would come and see you in concert.
Exactly.
So now it's like you go out and do the concert so they'll buy the, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of
It's selling reversed. The gimmicks. It's like in pro wrestling, when we did the independents, we perform so they'd sell it by our gimmicks.
Exactly.
And the same thing here. Instead of you go get on a line, that's not the way people do things anymore. And then once they get that autographed book, your book.
The book.
The Time of My Life.
Time of My Life.
And, or, you know, check you out at Harrah's and then say, okay, I want to get, you know, the whole album, not just download a certain song. I can get that autographed here. And that's the other thing, the personability. When you get in front of people and they can touch, feel you, talk to you, they're more likely to love your music even more and buy more things.
Yeah. Well, you know, as, you know, being in the wrestling business, that you know, a lot of it is personality.
Yeah.
You know, they have to care about you or hate you. One of the
I wish it was the same way it was before, but like the days of even, I think the business has changed in that way, because there's not personalities anymore.
Yeah, no. Yeah, it's kind of too spread out, a little like our business. I mean, Elvis Presley, thank God, he was the perfect guy at the perfect time.
Yes.
To really open up rock and roll, you know, or to open up, because his personality. And listen, Mick Jagger.
Yeah.
Good, bad, or I love Mick Jagger. And I've always said, you know, rock and roll is energy and attitude. And Mick Jagger is energy and attitude.
Yes.
And that doesn't mean it has to be good energy or good attitude. It just has to be Bob Dylan. Yeah,
exactly.
You can't take your eyes off him. He's not doing anything, but he's got that charisma. And that goes a long way in your business and our business.
I agree. Old business, but but I'm still involved in service.
Yeah, but he's a big guy, folks.
So I could still make my comeback at 46. Yes, if I wanted to, I could. Yeah. I love broadcasting. I love telling stories. I love teaching people how to promote
and build brands.
Because my belief is a brand. Whatever you are, if you don't have a brand, you're not going to be anything.
That's exactly right.
It doesn't matter if it's a business today. A business, an icon, anything. If you're not a brand, if people can't say, I see this brand, I recognize and understand it, and understand what they are, forget it. They're never going to make money, and they're never going
to... Yeah, if you don't have anything to sell, I mean, if you can't brand... I mean, the Righteous Brothers, we were branded without trying to be branded. We were two white guys that sounded black.
Right.
In those days, that was the stupidest thing you could possibly do, because if you were... sounded black, white stations wouldn't play. If you were white, black station. But that's just the way Bobby and I sang. Right. We weren't trying
exactly
to do anything, but we just kind of became a gimmick.
Yes.
Not trying to be a gimmick.
I love it, being a gimmick. That's important.
Yeah.
To be the gimmick. So, I mean, we could talk for hours, and again, we only have a shorter period of time. Both of us have definite prior game engagements here in Vegas, and I appreciate you taking the time. Mm-hmm. The point I wanted to go with is you had two careers, your the Righteous Brothers and your singles career.
Mm-hmm.
How did you guys get back together?
Well, we broke up in 68, and that's right when, like, the hippie thing started coming along here, beers,
yeah,
drugs, stuff. And because we were always the guys that you're replacing, you know, are considered the corny ones. Well,
yeah,
they do now.
Yeah.
Well, they wear suits.
And yeah.
And so I figured, well, you know, this is a good time for me to go back and relive or finish the dream. My dream was to be a singer-songwriter.
Okay.
And I just, by accident, became a Righteous Brother. So did Bobby. We just, by accident, became the Righteous Brothers.
Right.
And so I left the Righteous Brothers to go do that. And then, and did that, and did very well, by the way. I mean, I did, Vegas saved my life, by the way. And because we were told... when Love and Feeling was number one, our agent, Jerry Parencio, came to us and said, listen, go to Las Vegas now while you're hot, and it'll pay off for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
And it has. And it saved my life. And so I did real well. But then in 64, I lost my voice. And Bobby was having some financial problems. So... we decided, well, we needed each other.
Yeah.
And so we went back together in 74, and we recorded a song called Rock and Roll Heaven, went to number two in the nation, this and that. But it kind of wasn't a real Righteous Brother record. And then, so we were back together, and then in 76, my ex-wife passed away.
Okay.
And she was 32. We had a 10-year-old son.
Oh my gosh.
And I was a single parent, and so I didn't leave the Righteous Brothers. I just took some time off to go get me and my son on our feet.
Okay.
If I was married at the time, I probably wouldn't have done. So I didn't leave the Righteous Brothers. I just took some time off. And then I think, and that was in 76, and then 82, we did a 20th anniversary and some stuff. And then...
The movies.
The movies.
And then you got to get back together.
Got it.
That means guaranteed, because it's a brand. That branding changes, so there's two careers in certain ways, in two different eras. And everyone, the three songs you mentioned that I know real well from those movies, I'll never forget ever.
Yeah, I mean, the three songs, the gift that just keeps giving. I mean, they just, it was just magical. Yes. I mean, if you wrote a movie about it, you say, well, man, that's corny. That would never happen. But it happened, and we were bigger than ever. And so we worked from like 1990 until Bobby passed away in 03. And I just waited, and I never wanted to reform the Righteous Brothers, because the Righteous Brothers to me were Bob and Bill.
Yeah.
And so I put it off for 13 years or something, and then I just had a lot of fans and people in the business saying, man, come on, that people bring still want to hear that music. And I ran into a Bucky Hurd. I was doing some work in Branson, Missouri, and he was there, and I went in to see him because we had been friends for years. And he was doing some Journey songs, and I heard him. I said, holy mackerel. I mean, he just killed
me.
I said, well, if I was going to do it,
they're going to do it.
This would be the guy to do it with, because we were already friends.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can't just pick somebody out. It's like a mail order bride. Yeah. Come on, man.
Yeah, so you found the right person. Damn.
And then you find out you can't live together. But so he's been phenomenal. He's been a lifesaver. He's a great singer.
Right.
He's a great guy. And his sense of humor is wonderful. And he's real helpful. And so once again, man, I just walked in.
So how long have you been in Vegas with doing this show?
It's going on 3.5 years.
3.5 years, okay. Yeah.
And it's been very successful and a lot of fun. We work Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, about 30 weeks out of the year.
Okay.
We take the summer off. And because it's Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, we can go out on the road and do concerts.
Oh, wow.
So
you're on tour too. So you're available in Vegas.
And available on the road.
On the road. And best place is your website, right?
Yeah.
What's your website again?
Well, it's Righteous Brothers website.
Right, righteousbrothers.com. But everyone needs to pick up his book, The Time of My Life by Bill Medley. And that's amazing and all these different things. And come visit you in Vegas. When you're in Vegas, please, come see him.
Please. I guarantee you, you'll say, wow.
Can you give me a quick note? I've had certain people sing. What do you like, sing one little thing, little bar for me.
You never close your eyes.
Little, come on, little.
Anymore when I kiss your lips. That's enough.
I love it. That's perfect. All right. You're listening to Neil Haley's show, and we'll be back in just a moment.